The AANA is pleased to present the Wellness and Chemical Dependency in the Nurse Anesthesia Profession curriculum to increase awareness and knowledge of the need for each of you to be healthy and well. Many of you are viewing this curriculum as nurse anesthesia students. We're excited to have you begin this fulfilling profession. We believe it is imperative that you learn about occupational risk for addiction at this early stage of your anesthesia education. Equally important is for you to discover the need to adopt and employ healthy lifestyle behaviors throughout your professional tenure. Some of you are further into your careers and may personally know colleagues who have suffered the consequences of turning to unhealthy habits, such as drugs or alcohol, to cope with personal or professional stress. Whatever your career stage, professional lifestyles that promote effective coping, adaptation, and resilience can be taught, learned, and adopted. These modules provide a number of simple but essential elements to forge a long and healthy career. The overarching goal is to create a healthier workforce and, as a consequence, to optimize patient safety. The curriculum is presented in 6 modules. Each can be viewed independently by the learner at any time. Module 1 and 2 introduces general concepts and the dimensions of wellness, the threat of stress, and the need for resilience. Module 2 explores specific stress research data from the CRNA and student nurse anesthetist populations. Module 3 expands on these concepts, addressing specific healthcare stressors, and introduces the risks for chemical dependency and addiction. Module 4 imparts a broad overview of the disease of addiction, along with the signs and behaviors to recognize an impaired colleague. It also presents an introduction to understanding of mental health conditions, such as burnout and depression, and the impact of these on overall well-being. Module 5 speaks further to the consequences of the disease of addiction, introduces treatment and recovery, explores the challenge of potential reentry to the profession, as well as relapse. Module 6 highlights the concepts from the first 5 modules and offers resources for creating and sustaining a personal wellness plan. We hope that this curriculum introduces each of you to the concept of building your personal wellness arsenal of coping skills and resiliency strategies. The learning will facilitate the development of a healthy approach to stress reduction throughout your life. Finally, it will focus on the elements of sustaining healthy relationships, diet, exercise, and carving out adequate time for recreation as well as sleep and restoration. With knowledge as power, we envision that the increased awareness brought about by engaging with this module series will help reduce the incidence of substance abuse by CRNAs and student nurse anesthetists. It is further hoped that this knowledge may also prevent the threat of untimely death related to substance abuse in the anesthesia provider population. An impaired provider poses great threat, not only to themselves, but also to the patients in their care. We encourage nurse anesthesia educational programs to advance wellness and chemical dependency education during the student orientation and inculcate these principles throughout the program. The goal is to strengthen knowledge and coping skills and proactively seek balance to avoid professional and personal vulnerabilities. The AANA thanks the Curriculum Task Force volunteers who contribute to the content of these modules.
This is Module 5, Management of Chemical Dependency and Addiction, Intervention, Treatment, Rehabilitation, Recovery, Reentry, Return to Practice, and Avoiding Relapse. The management of chemical dependency is a complex process requiring behavior modification, and in some cases, pharmaceutical intervention too. We will discuss the logical progression of this process that starts with the identification of a substance abuse problem, followed by considerations for appropriate intervention, and of case-specific rehabilitation modalities. This will be followed by a discussion of the parameters of a commitment to recovery involving multiple adjunct therapies, which includes the sometime and highly individualized possibility of professional reentry with return to professional practice. Finally, we'll cover avoiding relapse through the continued commitment to a lifestyle of sobriety. The objectives for this module include being able to recognize the signs and behaviors of an impaired colleague, and know that it is necessary to get help. This includes an understanding of the intervention strategies and why it is important to do it right with professional guidance the first time. Additionally, you'll achieve the ability to discuss different therapies for treating chemical dependency in anesthesia professionals and recognize the importance of 12-step programs in the prevention of relapse and in maintaining sobriety and wellness. Other outcomes include understanding of the variables that influence rates of relapse and the potential limitations and barriers for successful reentry for anesthesia professionals. It is essential to focus on primary prevention in regard to substance abuse, which is an overriding principle of chemical dependency and addiction management. The importance of maintaining an effective wellness program cannot be underestimated. This includes a routine commitment to personal introspection that provides a continued situational awareness of fluctuations in regard to personal stress inventories and times of heightened individual risk. Toxicology screening has been shown to be a deterrent to substance abuse as well as an effective adjunct for those in recovery. In fact, certain industries regularly monitor professionals through mandated random toxicology screening. This is an entire debate in and of itself, beyond the scope of the material to be presented at this time. However, during this module, we will examine the ramifications of chemical dependency and addiction once the disease process has begun. In Module 4, we discuss the importance of early recognition, identification of signs and symptoms, and diagnosis. Recall the four A's of recognition: attitude, affect, attendance, and appearance. That being said, early intervention matters. We'll repeat that again. Early intervention matters. Early intervention saves lives. This is because the course of addiction among anesthesia professionals is extremely rapid due to the immediate accessibility of pharmaceuticals available to the dependent or addicted anesthesia professional. To this end, our most important focus is to save lives. In fact, this is the only focus at the time of intervention. Much later return to practice can be considered, which is evaluated on a case-specific basis and only for providers who have demonstrated a committed, diligent, and successful approach to the maintenance of a lifestyle in recovery. Substance abuse, chemical dependency, addiction. These each have tremendous impact, reaching far beyond the impaired individual. The impact extends to our patients, our professional community, to our friends, to our coworkers, to our employers, and beyond. The path to recovery mirrors basic nursing models: assessment, diagnosis, planning, intervention, evaluation. In the assessment phase, the problem is recognized. The degree of pathogenesis is considered with a best guess determination as to where the individual sits on the continuum of the disease trajectory. Planning follows, which is key as best practice intervention is paramount. Intervention should be done by an experienced individual after a safety net has been put in place. Consideration is given to the support system available to the impaired provider. This may be the only chance to make a difference. Please recognize the importance of planning the intervention phase, as the outcome will likely be greatly impacted by the professionalism and structure. When we get this wrong, it can be catastrophic, especially since intervention is the precursor to effective treatment. Intervention programs establish an effective mechanism to help the individual break through existing denial and to understand the need to seek treatment for the problem. Entry into treatment starts at this time. This may involve detoxification as well as rehabilitation. Treatment modalities are varied and case-specific. Multimodal approaches to therapy exist and are shown to be most effective. Finally, evaluation or continued evaluation of the effectiveness of the individual's compliance and commitment to recovery. This is a long-term prospect and a phase that must be considered for the rest of one's life. Any lapse in the continued and committed process, and we highlight this word process, of recovery, will put the individual at increased risk for relapse. Freedom from dependency and addiction is a lifelong process. Sobriety is a co-produced good, reliant on both an individual's personal strength and the ability to build and draw on a strong support system. Since an impaired individual is likely entrenched in the denial of having a substance abuse problem, there are several key issues to keep in mind in regard to developing an intervention strategy. It can be extremely difficult for family or friends to intervene without help. The value of a well-planned intervention cannot and should not ever be underestimated. Bryson and Hamza, 2011, warn that too often interventions are handled inappropriately. In their research, they provide a list of what should and should not be done, including having a trained interventionist present at all times. This is not a time to do it yourself. Rather, it is a critical juncture in the trajectory of an illness and requires the involvement of an experienced professional addictionologist. The timing of the intervention also has enormous impact. It is critical to have a treatment center already in place to receive the patient, including appropriate financial arrangements. There are some important considerations related to a successful intervention. Among health professionals, motivation includes the threat of lost income by loss of professional licensure and/or certification. Mandated treatment produces modest outcomes, similar to voluntary treatment, but professionals involved in therapeutic intervention must be trained to motivate the mandated. Those involved with the process should promise only what they will actually do, as poor follow-through will compromise trust. Interventional confrontation is known to make people defensive. Although confrontation is required, it must be done in such a way as to yield maximum cooperation. A proactive style is most effective. Expect ambivalence and assist the individual to overcome this by helping them embrace behavior modification through a basis of trust and hope. This type of support helps individuals to know they can do it. Motivational approaches based on these principles show great promise to promote change. As far as change itself, progress is the most important goal. This means small steps, not big ones. One change at a time, one day at a time. Incremental successes have enormous impact and eventually lead to a lifestyle grounded in recovery. Having taught an individual how to exist safely within the storm rather than expecting to achieve freedom from the storm. This distinction and emerging skill set is precisely what will ground an individual later, allowing them to manage life's continued challenges with greater stability. Perhaps your facility has policies in place for substance abuse or chemical dependency which can be followed. If not, often a critical event such as overdose or suicidal death can be the impetus for developing education for prevention and departmental substance abuse policies. Concerns may also be addressed to employee assistant programs within your facility. These programs offer free counseling to employees, and services are usually provided by a third-party vendor. Confidentiality is maintained in accordance with privacy laws and professional standards. The qualifications of the EAP counselors vary, as most states do not require counselors to be licensed. The Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration has a searchable treatment facility locator for treatment programs in your area. But importantly, it is recommended to contact your AANA state peer advisor, who can assist with locating a treatment center experienced in treating healthcare professionals. The AANA has a wealth of peer assistance resources online. from tips to handle interventions and recommendations for treatment center criteria specific for anesthesia professionals and a searchable directory of state peer advisors. Because of the unique treatment needs for anesthesia professionals and students, based on a variety of reasons, including controlled substance availability, potential professional losses when inadequately treated, professional guilt and shame, and a tendency to intellectualize the treatment process, the AANA Peer Assistance Advisors provide many resources. The AANA Peer Support Network, comprised of CRNA volunteers serving on the National Committee and as state peer advisors, are available to help individuals, families, managers, and supervisors through the process. The Peer Assistance Advisors' recommendations have been developed through their work starting in 1984, supporting chemically dependent colleagues. The treatment recommendations are very specific. Additionally, on the AANA online resources, you'll find a link to purchasing CRNA Bernadette Roche's book, Substance Abuse Policies for Anesthesia Professionals, which is a helpful resource for developing departmental policies. The Peer Assistance Advisors recommend that all chemically dependent anesthesia professionals receive treatment at a SAMHSA-certified inpatient comprehensive addiction treatment center experienced in treating healthcare professionals. Completion of a minimum of 28 days of inpatient treatment is recommended, with 90 days of treatment most desirable and offering the highest success rate. They do not advocate outpatient treatment for the disease of addiction in anesthesia professionals and students due to the high rate of recidivism. Any relapse after outpatient treatment should only be treated under the long-term inpatient modality. The remainder of the elements needed in a treatment center for best outcomes are listed online at www.aanapeerassistance.com, such as an emphasis on a long-term 12-step model of abstinence-based recovery and evaluation by an American Society of Addiction Medicine board-certified addictionologist. Additionally, as appropriate, evaluation by an American Academy of Addiction Psychiatry boarded addiction psychiatrist and neuropsychiatric and/or psychometric testing is recommended. Later in this module, we'll cover evaluation of suitability for timing of the return to anesthesia practice. The Peer Assistance Advisors' recommendations don't end with finding a treatment center. They advise compliance with continuing care after discharge, including relapse prevention techniques, recovering professionals meeting attendance, active participation in the 12-step recovery community, and monitoring of random urine drug screens. Early intervention plus early treatment plus a strong support system equals increased compliance and more consistent recovery. It also saves the lives of addicted anesthesia professionals and potentially also those patients in their care. Initial treatment is pivotal. In regard to laying the groundwork for long-term stability, the quality of initial treatment is key. Depending on the drug of choice, medical detoxification may be required, as quitting cold turkey could be deadly. Therefore, detoxification must be managed by a qualified medical professional. Furthermore, there is high comorbidity of addiction and mental illness. Psychiatric pathology must be addressed. Often, individuals abusing chemical substances are self-medicating an unrecognized underlying condition. When the acute phase of management is complete and an individual's status is stabilized through medical and psychiatric evaluation and intervention, including detox when necessary, other treatment modalities ensue. These include individual, group, and/or family therapy, 12-step program involvement, and maintenance pharmacotherapy. Therapeutic treatment plans are formulated based on the clinical needs of the individual. Effective treatment is multimodal and based on abstinence. Treatment should look at a broad range of improvements in areas such as family life, employment, management of legal ramifications, diet, exercise, and spirituality, ultimately leading to a holistic lifestyle focused on wellness and long-term abstinence or sobriety. Those facing chemical dependency and addiction should treat their disease with the same attention, monitoring, and ongoing intervention as any other chronic and potentially fatal pathology. Although there are many treatment options for substance abuse diseases, healthcare professionals are more likely to be treated within the medical model that recognizes substance abuse as a disease. Treatment modalities range from 12-step programs, as previously mentioned, group counseling comprised of other healthcare practitioners, pharmacotherapy, meditation, and behavioral therapy. There are several pharmaceuticals approved by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration indicated for the treatment of alcohol dependence. Disulfiram, or antabuse, causes aggressive vomiting, which is quite unpleasant, when a person drinks even a tiny amount of alcohol. This is a form of aversion therapy. A patient must take disulfiram daily until they're able to establish permanent self-control. Acamprosate, or Campril, has been shown to reduce alcohol cravings. It has recently become available in Canada. Acamprosate has been used in Europe for many years and is a welcome asset in craving management. It is thought to modulate GABA and glutamate neurotransmission to help reduce craving. It has minimal side effects. Naltrexone, or Revia, is a narcotic antagonist that, when used intravenously, can reverse an opiate overdose and is effective in reducing the cravings that addicts have following withdrawal. When taken orally, it may reduce the craving for alcohol and narcotic or opioids. The major side effects are nausea and abdominal pain. Naltrexone, as mentioned earlier, reduces both alcohol and opioid cravings. It is usually given 3 times a week in conjunction with behavioral therapy and can be used for long periods of time. McCants Katz in 2005 notes that naltrexone pharmacotherapy is often used by healthcare professionals returning to practice, as it doesn't have buprenorphine's potential for neurocognitive and psychomotor impairment. Methadone is an opiate drug that has proven over the last 3 decades to be a remarkable treatment for opiate addiction. Methadone acts chemically on the brain's receptors for opiate drugs. It fills these receptors, relieving the need for other opiate drugs. As you get used to methadone, it doesn't change behavior, feelings, or thoughts. There is no high from taking methadone properly. Hence, it doesn't fuel addiction. Although you will be physically dependent on methadone, you will be free from some of the compulsions of addiction. Buprenorphine, or Suboxone, is also an opiate medication that has the same effect as methadone, but is different in some ways. Suboxone is a combination of buprenorphine and naloxone, a compound that, if injected, blocks the effects of pain-killing opiates. Suboxone is a very safe drug, with minimal risk of overdose. Because of the safety-sensitive work of healthcare professionals, according to Hamsa and Bryson, 2012, returning to clinical work on buprenorphine therapy is not advised until studies indicate that it is safe. Rather, an abstinence-based approach to recovery is recommended to avoid the consequences of errors that can occur under opioid substitution therapy. There are various components that formulate an effective treatment program. As mentioned, it should be an inpatient treatment facility staffed by an American Society of Addiction Medicine boarded addictionologist. According to Galanter and colleagues in 1990, in a study of 100 recovering physicians, a 12-step program was identified as the most potent component of recovery. As anesthesia professionals are generally anxious to return to practice and income, the treatment and post-treatment components can contribute to the potential for success. Bryson and Silverstein in 2008 recommend a minimum of 1 year removal from anesthesia practice so focus can be placed on recovery. Clark and Farnsworth's 2006 study found that longer monitoring periods, 5 years, yielded higher success rates for recovery. Drug screen monitoring is recommended to be through a formal program administered by a state board of nursing or alternative program for a minimum of 5 years, though monitoring for the professional lifetime is ideal. The peer assistance advisors advocate for career length monitoring. Scientific research and clinical practice demonstrate the value of continuing care in treating addiction with a variety of approaches that have been tested and integrated in residential and community settings. No single treatment is appropriate for everyone. Best practice treatment involves a multimodal approach that is patient-centered and case-specific. Behavioral therapies predominate and are of paramount importance. These types of therapies are a mainstay of recovery. Pharmacotherapy is a helpful and sometimes required adjunct. Naltrexone, a mu opioid antagonist, has been well researched and recommended as a necessary component of the recovery process. Continual assessment is required, and the building of long-term support is a fundamental component of a successful recovery. According to the Betty Ford Institute, recovery is defined as a voluntarily maintained lifestyle characterized by sobriety, personal health, and living with respect for yourself and those around you. Recovery is an ongoing process, not a cure. Many of us are familiar with the 12-step programs. They are mentioned frequently in our pop culture. But these steps aren't part of a fantasy world as steps of a distraught, written character in a TV show or movie. These programs change lives and families. Alcoholics Anonymous, founded in 1935, was conceived to assist the recovering alcoholic. Other programs followed, like Narcotics Anonymous and Overeaters Anonymous, utilizing the foundation through the various routes of recovery. Each group, with various processes, bases its steps on three separate dimensions to promote healing: the physical, mental, and spiritual dimensions of wellness. Physically, the addict needs to identify the desire and compulsion to use a substance. In this dimension, the individual recognizes and acknowledges their weakness and powerlessness over the substance. Mentally, the addict identifies the obsession that promotes the behavior even when the outcomes are detrimental. The outcomes of behavior can be life-altering, both personally and to our community, placing our patients at risk for injury and leading to various other self-destructive behaviors. Included in each of the 12 steps is a spiritual awakening. In the spiritual dimension, the addict focuses on themselves as well as recovery and healing over time. The tenets of AA include the 12 steps and the 12 traditions. Together, these guiding steps and traditions serve as spiritual principles that reserve the original intent of Bill W. and Dr. Bob, who founded Alcoholics Anonymous. Some of the steps you may know of, such as the first step of admitting powerlessness over addiction, and the second of believing that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. The steps are available at AA support groups and online. Treatment for alcoholism or drug addiction that is based on the 12 steps of AA can provide individuals with a lifelong program to maintain sobriety and achieve a balanced and healthy emotional and spiritual life. The fellowship in these programs helps fight the tendency toward isolation and to keep away from people, places, and things that might lead to relapse. By joining such a program, a volunteer sponsor can help assist in the journey of recovery. Sponsors are support. They provide the shoulder needed for spiritual stabilization at times of unrest. And most importantly, they understand the struggle of addiction firsthand and have been successful. Therefore, they have the experience to guide along the road to successful recovery. Peer-based recovery support is the process of giving and receiving non-professional, non-clinical assistance to achieve long-term recovery from alcohol and/or other drug-related problems. Support from others is very important, especially from others who are in the same predicament that you are. They know what you go through. They've been through it and they survived, which could help you survive. Peer-based recovery support is provided by people who are experientially credentialed. Research by Dr. Robert Fiorentin from UCLA clearly quantifies the recovery benefits of utilizing weekly 12-step attendance as a treatment adjunct. The percentage is also almost doubled between patients who completed their treatment program but do not attend weekly meetings and the population attending weekly meetings. The message is quite clear. 7 days without a meeting makes 1 week. It is the continued commitment of the addict to working a solid program involving a 12-step model that provides results. Only with continued diligence and full awareness of the risks involved can an addict maintain a successful recovery. Even before treatment is completed, or sometimes even before it has begun, the discussion starts regarding reentry to work. But not everyone can return to their clinical anesthesia careers. According to anesthesiologist Ethan Bryson in 2009, the decision to allow re-entry should be made only when all of the factors that can contribute to relapse have been evaluated by a qualified personnel, and only if the recovering addict demonstrates commitment to a lifetime of abstinence-based recovery. Failure to complete the recovery treatment program and to remain drug-free disqualifies the individual from re-entering the anesthesia profession. Factors that increase the risk of relapse, such as family history of substance use disorder, the use of a major opioid such as fentanyl, and the presence of a coexisting psychiatric disorder, correlate with an increased incidence of relapse and should be considered with a professional addictionologist prior to re-entry to clinical practice. As referenced earlier and recommended by the AANA's peer assistance advisors, 1 year away from clinical practice is advised prior to re-entry, and this is provided that the anesthetist remains drug-free throughout the recovery process. Additionally, disciplinary action by the State Board of Nursing or by law enforcement may hinder re-entry or, in some cases, make re-entry to the profession impossible. Unfortunately, the nurse anesthetist has few options for redirection of career. For some newly sober anesthetists who work alone and lack the support or monitoring of colleagues, the risk of relapse can be too great, and an alternative occupation should be considered in order to avoid repeated encounters with abused substances. The timing of consideration for reentry is imperative. As mentioned, consideration of ability and readiness should be through consultation with professionals specializing in addiction and addiction psychiatry. Wright and colleagues in the 2012 AANA Journal article, Opioid Abuse Among Nurse Anesthetists and Anesthesiologists, cite research on the successful reentry to clinical practice for anesthesia professionals, but warns also of the high relapse rate. Because potent opioids are available in anesthesia workplaces, there is always the temptation for relapse, especially when opioids were the drug of choice. To avoid the risk of relapse, anesthesia professionals must have a planned back-to-work contract, which most commonly includes random drug testing, regular attendance at support group meetings, regular attendance at 12-step meetings, and practice provisions such as limited or prohibited handling of narcotics for a minimum of 1 year. The strength of the practitioner's support system, both at home and within the institution, is a vital component of the recovery process. Supervisors, co-workers, and family members are the safety net for the recovering addict, and they must be dedicated to the practitioner's recovery efforts. In some cases, the use of naltrexone, which blocks the rewarding effects of opioids in opioid addicts, may be necessary to prevent relapse. Aside from readiness and a plan, reentry to clinical practice can be a difficult process for the recovering anesthesia professional. In a 2011 article by Hamza and Monroe, they report findings from a 1996 study by Siebert and Domenis specifically looking at factors that are barriers to CRNAs returning to practice. The four most difficult issues were disciplinary actions, finding a position, working with managers and members of the administration uninformed about chemical dependency and addiction, and employers who are unwilling to monitor reentry requirements. The same study found the factors to be most helpful to maintain recovery: participation and sponsorship in a 12-step program, support group attendance, random drug screens, and serving as a recovery sponsor or mentor for others. Upon reentry, there can also be prejudice within the institution due to the stigma of addiction. The stigma can cause loss of respect, trust, and professional identity, which can be devastating to the newly sober practitioner. Honesty is recommended, which provides the opportunity of asking colleagues for their continued support. In addition to these things, the practitioner loses clinical privileges in the form of restricted access to narcotics and the inability to take call hours. This further complicates the reentry process and exaggerates the challenges associated with the loss of one's professional identity. The practitioner also forfeits his or her right to privacy, as supervisors are granted full access to personal records and locker space for the purpose of preventing substance misuse. Relapse is part of the disease of addiction, and failed reentry or relapse is probable, so preparation is ultimately important. Education of the addict, family, employers, and colleagues is imperative if reentry is to be successful. As noted, the timing for reentry is important to prevent the frequency of relapse. The pie charts contrast a historical representation of opioid addiction compared to non-opioid addiction in the terms of successful recovery, relapse, and mortality. Opioids, usually the drug of choice for anesthesia professionals, carries a high mortality and reduced incidence of successful recovery, as evidenced by the Menk and colleagues study from 1990. Comparison of two published studies shows the advancement of treatment modalities, as evidenced by Menk and colleagues' 34% success rate in 1990 among anesthesia residents, compared to the study by DuPont's group that found almost 80% success in physician health programs. Therefore, successful recovery is possible. Research and treatment now need to be aimed at the nurse anesthetist and student anesthetist populations. DuPont and colleagues attribute the physician health program's high success rate to its structural aspects of care management, frequent random drug testing, tight linkage to a 12-step program with abstinence standards, relapse management by intensified treatment and monitoring, and a continuing care approach with focus on lifelong recovery. Another study of physician health programs by McClellan et al. In 2008, this time in a cohort of 5-year outcomes of physicians treated for substance use disorders, found in 19.3% with known outcomes failed the program, but 80.7% completed treatment and resumed practice under supervision and monitoring. Usually, contracts stipulate monitoring the addict with random drug screens for 5 years post-discharge from programs. In some states, this is a mandatory requirement for reentry to practice, but should be encouraged for all reentry. Random sampling requires a knowledgeable and responsible party within the employer anesthesia department to monitor results. Part of the reentry process may include restrictions on drug of choice access and use and limitations, such as the individual cannot work out of state. Relapse, as defined by Domino et al. In 2005, is the resumption of substance use after initial diagnosis and completion of primary treatment for chemical dependency. It involves activation of neural stress pathways concerning the paraventricular nucleus-releasing corticotropin-releasing factor and noradrenergic activation, as well as changes in the mesocorticolimbic dopaminergic system. Such neuroplasticity is compounded by lasting changes induced by conditioning and learning. Thus, reentry into practice in our specialty of anesthesia is a thin and weak platform for safety if neuroplasticity is not changed with behavior modification. It's not impossible, but is increasingly more difficult. The evidence Domino and colleagues collected in a retrospective analysis of 11 years of outcome data from almost 300 chemically dependent healthcare professionals being treated in the Washington Physician Health Program indicates that the chemically dependent healthcare provider has a relapse rate up to 43% within the following 5 years post reentry, with an associated death rate of 8%. And even though research-specific evidence regarding relapse in anesthesia professionals is limited, information exists on specific triggers and risk factors for reinitiation of drug abuse. This is only a brief list of triggers and risk factors that may induce a drug relapse. A trigger is something that is frequently associated with addiction. It can be cue-based, such as people, places, and scents. An example is an alcoholic going to a bar. Other triggers can include stress or conflicts in the workplace, with family, etc. Context and/or environments, compounded with increased stress levels and easy accessibility to abusive medications, may depict the operating room as an ideal place for relapse. Surprisingly, or maybe not surprisingly, there are anonymous reports that indicate drug abuse among anesthesia professionals during surgical cases within the OR. Environments where drugs are used for the chemically dependent can serve as conditioned stimuli, eliciting expectations, thoughts, neural and neurochemical responses, as well as emotional, motivational, and behavioral responses, all leading to relapse, even in the operating room. Unfortunately, this is the reality for some chemically dependent healthcare providers. The top risk factors for relapse, according to the Domino Group study, include use of a major opioid, a family history of substance abuse, and dual diagnosis, a diagnosis of substance abuse with coexisting psychiatric disorder as classified under the DSM-4. When maintaining recovery, potential situations must be anticipated with a plan to avoid succumbing to triggers. Hamza and Bryson found in their 2011 study of anesthetists in recovery that a relapse prevention plan in place before exposure to medication from surgical procedures and other treatments helps avoid the relapse despite the triggers and cravings. The study by Domino and colleagues attempted to determine specific risk factors for relapse in almost 300 healthcare providers. To summarize their data, they found that 25% had at least one relapse, with the amount of relapses being indirectly related to the length of stay within the program. The majority of those who relapsed did so with their initial drug of choice, being a major opioid, which included fentanyl, sufentanil, morphine, mepiridine, methadone, heroin, and OxyContin. The majority of relapses occurred within 2 years of the program and was detected by chemical and/or workplace monitoring. And one of the most surprising finds in this study was that non-physician specialists had an increased risk of relapse than physician specialists, with evidence of a 43% relapse rate within 5 years. We believe that we, as highly educated healthcare professionals, need to recognize and incorporate this information and keep this in mind for ourselves and for others who may be chemically dependent so that we can help prevent relapse into drug abuse. Drug abuse is a cycle, and relapse is inherently incorporated in the cycle. Drug use leads to positive reinforcement and symptomology relief. Further use leads to acute withdrawal symptoms, and this cycle leads to more drug use and abuse. The next step for the chemically dependent is primary treatment. Stress exposure during their abstinent time frame leads to a maladaptive stress response that includes increased conditioned emotional and drug craving responses, compounded with a decrease in adaptive coping. The stress exposure and maladaptive stress response can lead to relapse. Naltrexone is sometimes used to reduce craving in some patients. Recommendations for those at an increased risk for relapse include standard protocol, with an emphasis on increased workplace monitoring, more frequent random urine testing with observed micturition, and more intensive long-term follow-up and group therapy. Obviously, remaining abstinent from substances is a two-way street, and ultimately the responsibility lies within each individual. Relapse rates for drug addiction are similar to other well-characterized chronic illnesses. This slide compares relapse rates for drug-addicted patients to those suffering from diabetes, hypertension, and asthma. Relapse is common and a part of the disease process across many illnesses. Thus, drug addiction should be treated and evaluated like any other chronic illness. Relapse can be avoided by reducing those events in one's life that triggered the addiction. These pillars are steps that can be learned and followed to maintain recovery. Knowledge of the warning signs and awareness of precipitating high-risk events. Situational awareness of feelings that lead to relapse, and once recognized, avoidance of these triggers. Continual renewal of a commitment to sobriety. Development of effective coping strategies, and maintenance of strong support systems. In the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous, the organization reminds those in recovery, God willing, we may never again have to deal with drinking, but we have to deal with sobriety every day. In 12-step programs, recovery guidelines regarding specific drugs, such as alcohol, are often generalized to an individual's drug of choice, for example, narcotics, such as fentanyl, or benzodiazepines, like midazolam. In all cases, preventing relapse poses an enormous challenge. For those achieving longevity in recovery, guarding against relapse is of utmost importance. Sobriety has to be tended to on a daily basis. As we know from the earlier parts of our presentation, the use of 12-step programs in recovery exhibits the highest success rate for long-term recovery. Once again, and worth repeating, the goal of intervention in the world of addiction as it pertains to our professional community is saving lives, not saving careers. Working an active program of recovery is what it takes to do this. Hopefully, your awareness of the occupational risk of addiction for anesthesia professionals is now heightened to know the need for healthy behaviors to prevent stress and the occurrence of drug abuse and addiction. Additionally important is knowledge of the signs and behaviors and where to find help for yourself or others facing chemical dependency. In closing this module, we highlight that once chemical dependency is identified, successful life-saving management includes well-planned, professionally moderated intervention, individualized multimodal therapy and appropriate behavior modification as key components of effective treatment and rehabilitation. A continued commitment to recovery, which must be recognized as a co-produced good, a commitment that is renewed regularly by a motivated individual, bolstered by strong lifelong support systems such as those found in 12-step programs, and finally, the avoidance of relapse, which is accomplished through keen personal introspection, continual self-reflection of personal stressors, and the avoidance of relapse triggers, such as persons, places, and things. This point of view leads to a heightened situational awareness and helps individuals to recognize threats to recovery. Recognition of such threats allows the individual to avoid relapse and to achieve a robust life centered in sobriety with the ability to maintain a healthy, prosperous, and successful life, able to build a bright future centered on personal wellness. Research on addiction and anesthesia professionals has increased in recent years, and several studies have been specifically on nurse anesthesia populations. Many of these have been produced by CRNAs, and most call for the need of continued research. As Wright and colleagues in 2012 state, anesthesia professionals have an increased risk of opioid dependency. Fortunately, the medical, nursing, and nurse anesthesia communities recognize this risk and have taken steps to improve prevention, early identification, and treatment of the problem. To accomplish these goals, continued dedication from these professions is crucial. Improving practitioners' health can only improve patient care. Future research that keeps this goal in mind will no doubt result in helpful information.
We hope the content from the Wellness and Chemical Dependency in the Nurse Anesthesia Profession curriculum modules will help each of you care for yourself as well as your patients. When you complete the curriculum, you'll find an increased knowledge of the occupational risk of chemical dependency in anesthesia professionals. The curriculum is designed to encourage you to build the ability to cope with stressors and to recognize the signs and behavior of an impaired colleague, as well as resources to find the available peer assistance when needed. The AANA provides supportive and supplementary information to this curriculum online. Go to www.aanawellness.com and follow the link for wellness, education, and research.